So, good morning to all of you. It's good to be participating in a workshop where we can discuss various aspects of research methodology. So, I've been given the task of describing various aspects of statistics in research, and I'll try to do that from my perspective of both biology and chemical engineering. But you'll quickly realize that many of the concepts that I talk about also apply to various other domains of science and humanities. I'm going to start by giving you more of a historical introduction to the topic. And then at a later stage, I'll actually define the theme of the talks that will follow over the next few days. So we, of course, have two sessions today. And in today's session, basically in today's two sessions, I hope to cover the elements of statistics. Now, so at this point, my focus will be on giving you an idea of what's important to understand and learn about. And during the course of the rest of the year and going into a subsequent workshop, you'll have time to read on elements of statistics on your own and then make a connection with the points which I'll provide to you as part of my discussions over the next few days. So let's straight away jump into this with a discussion of some of the historical aspects. And I find that this is an interesting way to go about talking about research methodology, because a lot of what we do now in terms of procedure arises because of certain historical events. There have been certain needs for development in mathematics at certain points in time, and certain people have developed certain techniques. And when you now try to make sense of these approaches, you really need to go back in terms of history and understand why things are the way they currently are in terms of what got done way back. And there are plenty of good examples as to how things were done in terms of historical development of this field. So it turns out that the word statistics itself relates to governance. And in fact, the root of the word statistics is the word state. So there's a connection between states and statistics. And it goes back to the fact that 500 years back, governments needed to figure out what was going on in the population, with the general population. And especially two things were on every government's mind. One was, where they're going to collect the taxes from? And second, where are you going to find people to build armies and go out and beat up other people? So finding money for taxes comes down to, if you think about it, figuring out who exists in your population and who earns what. Okay, and therefore, which corners of the world should you go towards if you want to collect money? So a lot of the early statistics development happens in Europe, where you have small countries, in fact, city towns, trying to develop details of the amounts of people, the numbers of people living in their vicinity, and therefore the amounts of money that they could potentially gather from these people to use to finance, among other things, wars. Sometime later, it turns out that churches, especially in Europe, start maintaining records of births, marriages, and deaths. So this is the first kind of systematic attempt at record keeping. And of course, once you start collecting lots of data, you can do things with data. You can analyze it, what we now call as data mining. So it dates back to the 1500s. And then it turns out that disease strikes Europe, in particular the plague, and it becomes important to safeguard the king, in particular the king of England, from the plague. And so how do you figure out how to safeguard the king? You've got to find out, this of course is England, and so the king is in London, so you've got to find out in the different suburbs of London how many deaths are occurring per month as a consequence of plague. And if there are too many deaths happening in one locality, then the king definitely doesn't want to visit that locality for a while. Okay, so now you've got record keeping, but record keeping with a specific intention, and that to record keeping being updated very frequently at the monthly kind of level. So the causes and places of death start being stored, and the movements of the king now reflect local events. And in fact, here's one of the first available notices dating back to 1662 by a gentleman called Grant, who is basically collecting data as to how many people are dying in a given period. Now, he does this and comes up with what we now call life expectancies. And basically, he points out that when you're born, okay, how long do you expect to live? So how long may you be expected to live, not just when you're born, but also given your current age? Okay, and he keeps tracks of deaths occurring for each age group. And if you look at a table like this, which is what he painstakingly collected, if you look at a table like this, what this immediately sets you up with is the ability to calculate the odds of any person living up to a certain age. So you now start seeing the elements of probability to entering into this data analysis. So data is being collected with safeguarding the king in mind, but this data also allows a person to sit down and figure out, okay, to what age maybe they be expected to live. So Edmund Halley of Halley's Comet fame starts getting involved in these kinds of calculations. And if you think of this life expectancy table, this is immediately of use for calculating life insurance premiums. Okay, because the amount of money you pay depends on how likely you are to die in the near future. Okay, so you see the elements of data being collected, data being mined, and a model being built, and that model being used to now conduct business. So in all of this, it's about data analysis, data keeping, and separately there's a bunch of people who are developing theory associated with probability. So when you nowadays study probability, you actually study probability and statistics as one topic. But the fact is, 200 years back, statistics was looked at separately, probability was studied by mathematicians, and the connection between the two had not been made. And so even though there were famous mathematicians like Bernoulli, Gauss, Laplace, these are people who are now famous for example, distributions like the Gaussian distribution, the role of a Gaussian distribution in connecting with statistics had not been identified. So in the 1800s, there's another major development, which is that Francis Galton starts trying to figure out what is behind the inheritance of intelligence. And so here, this is a somewhat dangerous idea nowadays, but the idea was that intelligent people would have intelligent children. And so the idea was how to breed more intelligent people. And so he tried to work out the genetics. Of course, genetics was not fully known then, but he worked right there, were figuring out the rules of inheritance of various features, in particular in intelligence. But in trying to figure out what correlates with intelligence, okay, Galton starts making a systematic study of a variety of measurements, for example, the life expectancy of a person, the heights of a person, and so on. So one particular problem which bothers Galton is when you take tall people and you then look at the sons of tall people, how come on average, the sons of tall people are not as tall as their parents, are not as tall as their fathers. Okay? So in other words, why can't tall people give rise to even taller children? So he makes this observation that though parents may be tall, on average, and so he is trying to be general here, on average, okay, the children, the sons in particular of tall fathers, tend back towards the average height. So in other words, the heights regress back towards the mean, and here's in fact the origin of the word regression. So when we talk of regression, actually what is being implied here, okay, is that the heights regress back towards an average value. We of course now use the word regression in a totally different sense. We talk about how, okay, a y variable regresses with an x variable and therefore generates for us, for example, a straight line model. But in the original study about 200 years back, regression had to do with heights, a study of heights. So inherently, therefore, both regression and correlation theory go back to this analysis. The next interesting use of statistics also happens in the 1800s, and it dates back to what is known as the Crimean War. And interestingly enough, it involves somebody who is not at all inclined towards mathematics. So hopefully you are aware of Florence Nightingale, who was a nurse who took care of wounded soldiers on the battlefield. and she wanted to convey some message back to the politicians in London. These were British soldiers fighting a war, okay, in Eastern Europe. Lots of Britishers were dying, and she wants to convey a message back to the politicians that they need to do something about the death rates of soldiers. And so she is the first person known to use a chart to represent deaths, okay, and therefore trying to influence policy, public policy. And what she does is come up with something called, now called, a rose chart, but it kind of looks like a pie chart. So if you look at this chart, okay, the pink sectors, so each sector here, each wedge or triangle reflects a particular month of the year. And she is trying to depict the total number of deaths occurring in each month of the year. And the pink relates to, so the pink at the center, towards the center, reflects deaths by injury. And the gray, which is the outer part of all these wedges, reflects death by disease. And black implies death by any other cause. So what is it that you immediately learn from this slide? You quickly learn by looking at this image that there are more people dying because of disease than because of warfare, because of gunshots. Okay, the gray area is much larger than the pink area. And so she is using this as a tool to quickly convey that at specific months of the year, there is a large number of deaths happening because of disease. And why is disease happening? Because there is lack of hygiene, with so many soldiers being forced to stay together in a very small area, in a tent, okay, without proper plumbing. And so really the request was to London to do something about the lack of hygiene, and therefore to start sending engineers across to the war front to set up elaborate plumbing systems. And as a separate note of curiosity, one of the first people to come to India and help us out with our plumbing was Florence Nightingale. So she, after doing this in the Crimean War, then proceeds to come to India and helps out, okay, in the 1800s itself with trying to spread awareness about the need for hygiene and the need for proper sanitary plumbing. So this is one of the first recorded, okay, charts. We of course don't like this rose petal type structure. We have now, okay, more familiar with the use of a pie chart, where each of your sectors is of equal radius. But you'll appreciate that rather than send an elaborate table of data back to a politician in London, the chart immediately conveys a message. And at this point, it's important therefore to realize that, okay, lots of data can be more better conveyed using pictures. So towards the end of today's sessions, I'm going to talk about pictorial representations of data and how that can be used to quickly convey messages. So continuing with our history, the next big advance is in the early 1900s, and it has to do with a gentleman called Carl Pearson, and he develops many procedures to allow scientists to test for specific hypotheses. So what we nowadays call a hypothesis testing procedure actually dates back to the early 1900s and Carl Pearson, and of course there were other statisticians who developed these procedures at about the same time along with him. So there is this very interesting story about a brewery, Guinness, okay, which is famous for making beers of different types. And around this time, when Pearson is starting to work on hypothesis testing, it turns out that this particular brewer, in fact, he's a chemist. So you don't expect to see mathematicians in a brewery. So it turns out in those days, if you're trying to make beer, breweries would hire people with microbiology and chemistry backgrounds, because after all, there's a fermentation involved using a microbe, and you need to understand, okay, the basics of chemistry as you start manipulating, okay, both the recovery of your product and also the quality of it. So it turns out that there are several problems affecting the brewery, and if you understand a little bit of the beer making process, you'll actually appreciate a lot of the statistics that has been developed in the 20th century. So let me kind of spend a little time on this one example, and we'll keep coming back to this example over the next few sessions as we talk about actual approaches towards hypothesis testing and the need for specific tools in statistics. So what kinds of problems impact somebody trying to make beer? It turns out in those days, and we are talking of early 1900s, okay, beer is made at a plant in England or Ireland, but the British soldiers are all over the world and they all want this beer. They want this particular brand of beer. So what must be done? You must make the beer and you must ship it out to different corners of the world. How do you send beer out to different corners of the world? You do it using barrels. So you fill up barrels full of beer, put them on ships, and then you send them to different parts of the world. So one important problem immediately arises. If the barrels are going to be on ships and the ships are going to take different amounts of time to go to different parts of the world, how do you ensure quality control? How do you know that the taste of beer in a barrel, and for that matter the amount of alcohol in that beer in a barrel, how do you know that it remains the same? It remains the same after traveling on a ship for 1 month or traveling on the ship for 5 months. That's one problem. The second problem that the brewery has is, how do you fill up the barrel? Because somebody who gets a barrel which is half empty is obviously going to be annoyed because they have been sold less. On the other hand, if you fill up a barrel with too much beer, that's not profitable for the company either. So now you have a kind of filling problem. You want the same volume of beer packed or poured into each and every barrel that is going to be sold. So we need some quality control on the taste and effect of beer, and you need some quality control on the volumes being packed into barrels. And by the way, the taste of a beer also relates to the grains being fermented away to ethanol. The grains have starch, starch gets converted into ethanol, and it turns out a lot of the flavor of the beer has to do with which types of grains, and for that matter where the grains are grown. And just like we have different varieties of rice from different parts of our country, it turns out that you have different qualities of grain. In this case, the grain is barley. So you have different qualities, different tastes therefore of barley. And therefore, if you now identify one good strain of barley, the question comes about, how do I mass produce barley and how do I ensure that I get the maximal yield of barley in a given plot? And so roughly at around this time, people also start noticing that if you add nitrogen to soil as a fertilizer, you're going to improve the amount of barley or wheat grown. So here's an interesting problem that the brewery comes up with. How do I ensure quality control for the barley that's being produced, or for the wheat that later on other agriculturists want to produce? How do you ensure quality control? How do you maximize the yield? And all of these involve problems in statistics. How do I know that adding fertilizer improves my yield? It's a simple thing that we take for granted now, but 100 years back, the question was, how do you know that adding fertilizer systematically makes a difference? How do you know it causes an improvement in the yield? And how do you know it was that increase in yield you might see is not because of some other factor? So a lot of what this company did 100 years back, and a lot of the agricultural biology research that was done 100 years back, actually strongly influences a lot of the research methodology that we now use. So it turns out that with so many problems facing this brewery, the lead brewer at this company, a guy called Gossett, the picture on the right of your screen, he decides that we need some help from mathematicians. And since there's no mathematics happening inside a brewery, the only way you learn a little bit about mathematics is if you actually go to a university and enroll as a university, and you actually have a very interesting occurrence, which is somebody trained in chemistry decides that they need help from mathematics, and they actually take the effort, okay, and this is somebody who is already middle-aged, they actually take the effort of starting effectively a new degree, basic degree in mathematics, by joining Carl Pearson's lab and getting trained in the basic methods of statistics. So remember, Carl Pearson is a guy who has developed all these testing procedures, but the issue is this: he is testing these procedures on fake data, not on practical data which are of interest to industry or to scientists around him. So here's a guy who needs this math in his process, Gossett, and he makes the jump, and it's very courageous for somebody not trained in math to make this jump. He makes this jump, goes and spends time at this brewery, quickly realizes that new math must be used, for example, to explain to what extent does the volume of beer in a barrel vary from barrel to barrel. So if you're trying to work out what is the variation in volumes, it turns out that the existing theory at that point in time, 100 years back, could not explain the variation. So clearly there's need for new theory. And who's going to develop a new theory? Nobody shows interest in this guy's problem of beer production. So the only way out is for the chemist to go learn math and develop new theory. So there's a moral in this, which is that if you realize that you need a specific skill in terms of your research problem, don't expect that you'll find a ready-made solution. Sometimes you may need to go out of your way, learn a new skill, and then implement it and come back and solve your original problem. So after spending a few years at Pearson's lab and after coming up with this new theory, and we'll discuss this theory in a subsequent lecture, Gossett comes back, applies this theory to the brewery process, specifically to this problem of filling up a barrel with beer, and realizes that the new theory perfectly explains the empirical observations that he has with the amounts of beer in a barrel. And of course, now they're all satisfied at the brewery. A sad thing happens in terms of science, which is, despite developing new theory, Gossett is not allowed by his company managers to publish his research. Why? Because if other breweries find out how to better fill barrels with beer, then this competitive advantage that their company has just gained is lost. So the theory is kept to themselves until a compromise is reached, which is Gossett publishes his work but doesn't announce his name and doesn't announce that he is working at a brewery. He simply publishes the math theory, and in his publications he puts down his name as a student of statistics. So all his theory, all of the good theory of dealing with small samples and trying to infer results given very few samples, dates back to Gossett. And we'll see distributions like the student's t distribution. Some of you have done statistics might remember a t-test, but unfortunately the scientist's name goes missing in all of this development. So personally, I find this story very inspirational, particularly because of what I told you. Somebody goes out of the way to map a science problem onto a math problem, realizes they don't know math, goes and learns math, comes back and applies the math back to the original science problem, proves that it works, okay, and does it without necessarily trying to gain glory in terms of personal publications. Now, while Pearson and Gossett are busy trying to figure out how to deal with beer, a chap called Ronald Fisher is investigating other problems in population biology and agriculture. So Fisher has a role to play in genetics, but really what I'm going to tell you about is the role he plays in agriculture. And in agriculture, okay, there's, as I just told you a little while back, there's this problem of, should one add fertilizer to a plot of land? And fertilizer is not necessarily dirt cheap. So is it worth your while to add fertilizer to a plot of land to get a higher yield, in this case of wheat? So Fisher is a person who spent his life developing many advances in statistics, and to list some of these by their formal names: analysis of variance, okay, and that has to do with how do you ensure that one batch of a product is equivalent to another batch of a product. This is very important. For example, if you're talking of batches of vehicles being manufactured or batches of drugs being manufactured, how do you make sure, for example, that the amount of insulin packed into a vial, okay, made today is going to be equivalent to the amount of insulin packed in a vial made tomorrow? And that's very important, of course, for the end user, because they should not see variation in the insulin per vial. So the variance or variation, okay, in the amount of insulin from batch to batch needs to be analyzed, and that's analysis of variance. Then there's design of experiments, which is, if you think you've got yourself some process and you want to optimize this process and you think you don't understand the physics behind what's going on, So how do you very quickly do a set of experiments to try and optimize your process, okay, and come up with a better operating condition? So that's design of experiments. Then is also Fisher is also the person who developed theoretical concepts like maximum likelihood, pattern recognition tools like discriminant analysis and classification theory. But as far as we are concerned, okay, he is important to us because of the randomized experiment concept that he developed about 80 years back around this aspect of whether fertilizer should be added to plots of land. So I'll come to this in more detail in a later talk, but in a nutshell, the problems that Fisher had to deal with is, if you're going to try and prove in your research that adding fertilizer makes a difference to your productivity, you've got to actually rule out the impact of any other variable in your analysis. For example, if you're going to try to say that adding fertilizer to a plot of land is the reason why you're getting more of a yield, then how have you made sure that, for example, the water content of soil or the basic fertility of the soil itself, how are we making sure that those are not factors which influence the productivity? So this leads to a randomized experiment. And in one of the subsequent sessions, as I said, I'll discuss this aspect of randomization in great detail. Coming to India, it turns out that India also has a very good history in statistics. So in fact, we now have the Indian Statistical Institute in Calcutta, and its founder, Mahalan Abbas, turns out to be a very prominent person when it comes to theoretical statistics. Many of his discoveries are used particularly in pattern recognition. It turns out that he is Ronald Fisher's student. Fisher visits this institute in 1937. And there's also C.R. Rao, who's a very prominent statistician. In fact, who's received the highest award that can be given a civilian in the United States for all the contributions he's generated in the field of statistics. So that's basically my overview of history of statistics. And so let's get down to, given that I've already brought up a set of issues, let's get down to what I expect to cover in my talks. So let's start with, before I list the exact topics, let's start with a typical modeling procedure that you may expect yourself to be following. So any scientist is going to be concerned with some model, some physical model. There's some process you're interested in, and you're going to try to come up with some description of it, and then you're going to come up with some mathematical formulation of that physical model, and that model that you come up with will have parameters in it, and then you'll start making claims about that particular, those particular parameters. For example, a physicist might claim that force is proportional to mass, and in particular, if you're trying to study gravity, he'll go ahead and claim that the theory is that force is proportional to mass, and there is a proportionality constant there, which is that constant g which we know of, acceleration due to gravity. So in step two, the physicist might then go ahead and claim that acceleration due to gravity should take on a particular value, for example 9.8 meters per second square. And then you get down to doing experiments, and you start asking the question, are these estimates of this value of g that I calculate, are they equivalent to what is being proposed? In other words, supposing I do some experiments and I find out that my acceleration due to gravity is 9.7, I'm left with this question of, is 9.7 equivalent to 9.8, in which case the theory that I've proposed has to be considered correct. So it's invariably this iterative process. There's a model being proposed. There are some parameters in the model you will identify and make statements about or claims about, and then you've got to go do experiments and figure out whether the observations that you have are consistent with the claims, and if the observations are consistent, then you claim that your model is valid. So where is the role of statistics in this? Statistics requires that any observations that you come up with be contrasted with your model. Okay, so I want to be very clear about this, and I'll repeat this many times throughout my sessions. Statistics does not set you up with a hypothesis. So statistics has nothing to do with the first point. You have a problem, that you are looking at in your domain, whether it's electrical engineering or mechanical. Okay, it's for you to come up with some physical model. You want to make a claim about a parameter in the model, that's your business. So Newton might claim a 9.8 meters per second square, okay, but that's just a claim for a model. Statistics comes in when you do experiments and you want to ask the question, are the results realistic and are they consistent with the model? Okay, so this business of concluding on the validity of a hypothesis is where statistics will come in. And so really don't confuse the first creative task of coming up with a model in the first place with the systematic statistical task of reconciling your observations with the physical model. So there are two parts to this. And the reason I make a big fuss about this now is that if you go pick up any statistics book, the statistics book textbook will spend a lot of time talking about collection of data, how to describe it, how to analyze it, and how to come to a logical conclusion. But it will have nothing to do with how to come up with a hypothesis in the first place. So you have already had some sessions, I think, by Professor Karmakar, talking about how to set up a research problem and how to identify a hypothesis in your specific problem. So where I am going with this is that I am going to continue off from the point where you have already identified a hypothesis, you already have a model, you are about to start an experiment where you are going to collect data, and we will spend time talking about what are the issues involved in the collection of data, how to describe data, how to analyze this data, and how to identify logical conclusions from your data. Now really it's really unrealistic to do a whole course in statistics in 3 or 4 sessions. So before we go ahead, I'm going to point out a few textbooks that you can pick up on your own and read up later. So remember, all these books explain how to use statistical methods, but they do not spend time on why you use these methods or when to use these methods. And therefore, what I'm going to do is, in my set of lectures, I'm going to spend time on why and when. And hopefully that's of use to you as you try to formulate your own research problems. So the reference books that I would recommend at this point, and I do not recommend, quite frankly, any of these very strongly. There are plenty of good books out there. Okay. These are some of the books that we prescribe at IIT for our data analysis course. And in fact, we have realized that in addition to physics, chemistry, and mathematics, the incoming undergraduate students, the BTECs, now must do a data analysis and interpretation course as a compulsory course in the first year itself. Okay, that's how strongly we feel that statistics and data interpretation is important to the new engineer. And the books we have prescribed for that course on data analysis are listed here. Okay, but the point is, there are plenty of equivalent books out there. Pick up one of them, go through these books, and at some point revisit some of these lectures and handouts that will remain on our website, and try to make a connection between how to use the methods in these books with why you're using them and when you're using them, which is what I'm going to spend time on. So why are we using statistical approaches? Because invariably you have a hypothesis which needs some analysis. The hypothesis, will turn out, is about a value that a model parameter will take, about the relationship between variables, and the form of the model itself. So for example, if you look at the first point, the value taken by a model parameter, the hypothesis could be about whether acceleration due to gravity is 9.8 or not. Alternately, the hypothesis could be about whether two variables that you have in your process are related to each other. So is there a connection between X and Y? How do you prove that X is related to Y? And finally, if you already know that X is related to Y, what is the form of the model you should start using to describe Y as a function of X? Is it a straight line model? Is it a quadratic model? What kind of shape, what kind of curve, what kind of function will you use to describe this relationship between the model? So before we get into nitty-gritties now of statistics, one final set of words of caution. not using statistics in research can be very dangerous. And we are typically guilty of doing experiments, for example, once or twice, and then making big claims about theories based on the few observations that we have. That's invariably because we are ignorant of how to use statistics in our methodology. But it's also possible for statistics, without a proper question, to be pointless or even dangerous. So I'll give you one example of where statistics can be dangerous. And later on, when I talk about pictorial statistics, I'll give you further examples. So it turns out that there have been studies on IQ of children. And the IQ, in particular, of children from rural areas versus urban areas. And if you know the IQ scoring system, typically if you get an IQ of around 100 or 120, that's supposed to be a good IQ. 150 is genius. At least you can label yourself a genius if you have an IQ of 150. So with an IQ of 120, if that's average, the question that somebody might want to ask is, do rural children, for instance, have an IQ on average less than 120? Well, that basically implies that they have fewer opportunities and don't have access to a good educational system, and in general don't have awareness of events around them. So here's how the study for this particular hypothesis is done. The hypothesis is, do rural children have an IQ less than 120? And one can assume that 120 is the IQ of an urban child on average. So are rural children worse off than urban children? And that statement is being statistically tested by asking, is the IQ of a rural child on average less than 120? So there's a model, there's a model parameter, the IQ, and there are experiments to be done. And the experiments will involve going out now into rural areas, carrying out these IQ tests on children, collecting all these IQ scores, and then compiling an average. And so this test is done, and the average comes back as 118. So here's the question now. Is a rural child worse off than an urban child, given that 118 seems to be the average IQ, and that is less than 120? So how do you prove or disprove this? It turns out that if I want to show that 118 is significantly less than 120, there are ways of doing it in statistics. Okay, there is a statistical procedure which will allow you to systematically show that even if there were measurement errors in the IQ test, that 118 is so close to 120, okay, but sufficiently far away in terms of, okay, this 2-mark difference in a large sample set. So the net result is that whoever is carrying out this test has the ability, if they do the test properly, of saying 118 is different from 120, is less than 120, in which case the rural child is worse off. Now, this kind of a study will obviously impact spending, for example, because now if you prove that a rural child is worse off than an urban child, then that implies that the government should do something about it and spend money, which of course is a good thing for money to go into rural sectors. But there's one small problem with this, which is that when the exam for the IQ test is set up, okay, it works with marks which are rounded off in sets of 5, in units of 5. So the net result is 115 had no business being differentiated from 120, and definitely therefore 118 had no business being differentiated from 120. So the way the test is being carried out, there's no real conceptual difference between a score of 118 and 120, which means you should not have even bothered to ask the question, is 118 less than 120? But once the question got asked, and once you ask a statistician to evaluate all the data, the statistician, the theoretician does his work and comes back with the conclusion that 118 is indeed less than 120, therefore one group is worse off than the other group. So what this example tells us is that you have no business setting up that hypothesis in the first place. But if you do set up a hypothesis, there's a procedure to take on that hypothesis. And you can blindly follow that procedure. And you can come to a conclusion. So therefore, there's this question, of whether the hypothesis and subsequent use of a conclusion are meaningful or not. And remember, the statistician cannot really comment on why you are trying to set up a hypothesis in the first place. The statistician does not know the physics of it or the sociology of it. The statistician just knows how to crunch numbers, with the net result that if you ask the wrong question of a statistician, you could end up with a meaningless result back, which you then take forward into the subsequent research that you do. So, with that kind of a set of cautions to what I've said so far, I now want to kind of summarize which are the important themes that I'll try to put forward in the set of 6 talks that I have been assigned to give in this workshop. So, I'm going to start with talking about random variables. I'm going to spend a lot of time talking about random variables. It turns out most people do not understand the concept of random variable, and we abuse this in terms of how we carry out our experiments. So, we'll talk about random variables and how to figure out their values. Then we'll talk about how to test a hypothesis the formal way. We'll spend a lot of time asking, how can I not just test a hypothesis, but how can I fool a hypothesis test? So, in other words, how can we abuse the procedure for a hypothesis test? I'm going to spend time talking about how are variables related to each other. So, in other words, how are they associated with each other? And it turns out in science, we spend a lot of time asking, what's causing what? So, causality. So, given that I know that some variables are related to each other, can I go one step ahead and make comments about what's causing what? And then finally, we'll spend time talking about building and testing models. Okay, how to, given a set of variables, how do I figure out which of these variables are relevant, okay, to me? And we'll limit ourselves to talking about simple linear models, and I'll spend some time talking about some flaws in the procedure we normally employ in fitting a straight line, something as straightforward as a straight line. Towards the end of my sessions, I'm going to kind of provide an overview of all the various concepts that I have already talked, and we'll end up describing how various problems arise with published research. And I'm not necessarily talking about research that you and I may do. This involves problems coming out of places like MIT, Stanford, the top universities. Everyone's guilty of this. Okay, everyone is guilty of ignoring some element of proper systematic experiment design, and we'll spend time talking about how we can best make up for such issues. So, with that, I'm going to get into a discussion of the first major theme, which is random variables and their estimation. Now, what I would encourage you to do is, some of this is going to be new to most of you. So, if you have difficulty following with the discussion, either in terms of not following the math or in terms of having specific queries about the philosophy of the approach itself, feel free to put up these questions on Moodle or on chat, and I'll get back to them, okay, as we reach the end of the session. For those of you who are not comfortable with math, and I understand there are plenty of participants from the humanities, the point of it is that statistics need not be math intensive. And I'm deliberately trying to avoid a discussion of math. So, really pay attention to the methodology involved, not to the math involved, and it should be fine. So, our discussion of random variables literally starts with asking, what's a random experiment? Because a variable involved in a random experiment will end up being called a random variable. And so, here's a very funny notion. There's something called a random experiment. So, by the way, there's also, and I showed this in a previous slide, there's something called a randomized experiment. So, these are two different things, random experiment and randomized experiment. Randomized experiment I talk about later when I talk about how to devise good experiments. But a random experiment is something, for example, that you see when you toss a coin. So, why then is something like a coin toss thought of as a random experiment? So, the reason for me to start all of this is, it will turn out that practically every observation that you come up with in your research is likely the outcome of a random experiment. Okay? You might not think of it as that. You might think that you are in full charge of your research problem, that you know what you are doing, that you know how to control all the various factors in your experiment. But nevertheless, even if you think you are in full charge of your experiment, it will turn out that what you are doing is a random experiment. So before you think of your own research problems, first think of the coin toss. So why is the coin toss interesting, okay, as an example of a random experiment? What are the features of a coin toss? So where do we use a coin toss? So think of a cricket match. So before the cricket match starts, obviously there is a coin being tossed to ask who starts off, okay, with, for example, batting. So why do we like a coin toss as a way to start off a cricket game? Because we think basically that it's fair. It's fair to both the teams. We think that it's fair, but we also think that the outcome of that coin toss is not known to us in advance. There's no bias in there. So each team has an equal chance going into the event of a coin toss, and therefore each team has an equal chance of winning the game at the outset. So if I kind of write that down in a more formal way, okay, what's actually important about the coin toss with three sets of things. The first was that you knew all the outcomes of a given coin toss in advance. You knew that when a coin was tossed, that it would come up heads and tails. Okay, so that's important to you. The outcomes are known in advance. So when you do an experiment, the outcomes must be known to you in advance. And be careful here. I'm not saying that the outcome of a specific trial is known to you in advance. All I'm saying is that if you carry out an experiment, for example, if you're trying to measure a pH in a particular reaction, then the pH is a value between 0 and 14. Okay? So you know that the outcome of the experiment of measuring pH is going to end up being a value between 0 and 14. So your outcomes are known in advance. The set of values that you can expect to see are known to you in advance, okay, with the coin toss. But very importantly for you, the actual event occurring on the next trial is not known to you. That's why we like the coin toss. We know it's heads and tails, but we don't know what's going to happen to us on the next coin toss, which is what gives it that element of fairness. But then there's also this aspect that the coin toss, if repeated again and again, is an identically repeatable experiment. That's also important to us. If the coin stopped being fair after one toss and suddenly started being biased, where you're getting more heads than tails, then that experiment with that coin toss where you get an outcome with an initial toss is no longer relevant to you, because what's going on with that coin is changing with time. So that would be a useless way to start off a cricket match with that particular coin toss. So therefore, okay, when you look at your own experiment, think again, for example, of measuring a pH or measuring, let's go back to this acceleration due to gravity. If you're going to try and measure the acceleration due to gravity, then the value taken by pH or acceleration due to gravity must be known to you in advance in terms of a range. You must know the set of values. No surprises. You can't do the experiment and suddenly see a new value come up. Okay, so you cannot in effect change the rules of the game when you're halfway through an experiment. So the outcomes must be known to you in advance. You know that the pH is between 0 and 14. You know that the value of acceleration due to gravity is greater than 0 and less than infinity. The actual outcome of the next experiment you do will not be known to you in advance. You will do it. You will get a specific value for pH. You will get a specific value for acceleration due to gravity. Right? But then it becomes important for you to be able to go back and do the experiment and repeat it under identical conditions. So the conditions that you are going to work on are going to change. That creates problems. Now this impacts a lot of science, which is where experiments are difficult to conduct. For example, the coin toss, of course, is very easy to repeat. You can keep tossing a coin. But if I ask you to prove or carry out an experiment to study global warming, this is not an experiment you can do easily. In fact, this is an experiment that nature has been carrying out for years, as we have steadily changed our CO2 levels in the atmosphere. In fact, there is no possibility of repeating this experiment at all. Okay, once you've got global warming and once your climate is destroyed, it's not like you can reset everything and start the experiment all over again. So that's an experiment you cannot repeat. So you might have some theory as to what causes global warming. You might know the set of outcomes for example, of the temperature in the atmosphere as a function of global warming, as a function of CO2 levels. But these are not experiments you can repeat at a global scale under identical conditions, because you will never go back to that original climate condition. So then talking about random experiments in the context of climate research is totally different from the context of measuring pH in a reaction, or in the context of carrying out a physics experiment to measure the acceleration due to gravity. So we are going to, for the moment, restrict ourselves to talking about experiments which we know we can repeat and which we know we can reset and repeat under identical conditions. That's important. And once we have got ourselves an experiment that can be repeated under identical conditions, we characterize such an experiment as a random experiment. So what's random about this? What's random about it is that the outcome of the next trial is not known to us. But that doesn't mean we have no control over what's going on. It simply means that, okay, we have a model, we have a hypothesis, we have a set of values that we expect will show up. But the precise outcome for one precise trial will remain unknown to us until we do it. And when we do it, we'll be in a position where we get asked, can you repeat your experiment? And if you repeat your experiment, you'll get asked, do all your values average out to something nice? For example, are all your measurements of acceleration due to gravity converging towards this value of 9.8 meters per second square? So it turns out that a variable involved in a random experiment automatically gets called a random variable. So the experiment is more important, the variable follows. Now there's something important to us as we start talking statistics or data analysis, which is that the moment I talk about variables, I must have some numbers associated with this. Because in mathematics, if I'm going to compute things like an average, I need numbers. I can't tell you the average of a heads and tails, for instance. I can't tell you the average of an A grade in a course and a B grade in a course. There's no such thing. But I can tell you the average of marks in an exam. Okay? And why is that? Because marks are numbers, grades are not. So one of the key things that we need whenever we do our research is, if you've got some phenomena which has to be described with things like grades, okay, A, B, C, D, that doesn't help us much with further analysis. So we quickly got to find out a way to map these grades to numbers. And once we've got these numbers, okay, we can try to figure out real values to try and map these numbers. Okay, and then ask questions like, is one numerical value more likely to happen than another numerical value? So practically all our research boils down to figuring out where are the variables coming from in a random experiment, and how do we then map these to numbers, and how then do we make comments about the numbers that we see. So let's very quickly look at the coin tosses. So if I come up with a set of coin tosses, heads, heads, tails and heads, we are not talking of a random variable. So the coin toss is a random experiment, but the outcomes as listed as heads and tails is not a random variable. Why? Because I don't have numbers there. So I need a mapping to numbers, and it takes some effort on your part to say that, for example, if you get heads, then let x equals 1, or if you're looking at two coin tosses in a row, okay, if you're looking at two coin tosses, then what should happen? You have four possibilities: heads, heads, tails, tails, heads and tails, and tails and heads. Okay, but those are not outcomes for you, those are not numbers. But you can then define a random variable like x, which says, look, count the number of heads you have when you tossed a coin twice. In which case, if you have heads and tails as your two outcomes in that one attempt at that experiment that you do, then your random variable x is taking on the value 1. And similarly, if you got two heads when you tossed twice, the random variable x takes on the value 2. So now, for the most part in physics, our variables already have numbers to them. So the moment, for example, I talk about force or mass or acceleration, these already have numbers, real numbers. So we don't have to worry. It's only in problems where you have labels or categories or grades associated with your phenomena of interest that you need to worry about how to convert from these grades to numbers. So remember at this point that though I have myself a random variable x, which may take on values 1 or 0 or 2, it doesn't mean that I have no control over what's going on. In fact, the question now comes up, how does this random variable that I've looked at help me learn more about what's going on in terms of the average value in my process and the variability in my process? So, the moment you've got yourself a random variable, anything you do further using this random variable is also a random variable. For example, if x is a random variable, then x square, which is a function of x, is also a random variable because it depends on what the outcome will be for that next trial, for that next set of coin tosses. Kind of sounds obvious, but these are important to us because we invariably in our research stop paying attention to whether terms in our physical model are variables or constants. And it's important to recognize that if something is derived from something else, if one variable is derived from another variable, and that first variable is a random variable which has varying values which depends on the trial that you are about to do, then the second variable cannot be a constant. It also depends on the outcome of a particular trial or an experiment. Now, this is something which every teacher in an engineering lab has probably seen. Okay, so what happens in most engineering labs? There are groups which will do the experiment and several groups between them. For example, if the groups are trying to do an experiment on let's take an example from electrical engineering now. So, if you are trying to use different resistors and you are applying different potential drops across the resistors, you are going to be required to compute the current through the resistor. So, this is a simple straightforward application of Ohm's law. So, this experiment involves now using different resistors, applying different potential drops, and then asking what's the current flowing through the resistor. Solve for I in V equals RI, right? So, you will find that every batch of students who does this experiment will more or less come up with the same value. In fact, the tendency with most students is to try and match the value that they get in their experiment with the value that the previous batch got in their experiment. So, everyone ends up with practically the same value because everyone is looking at everyone else's report. And why is that? Because you're all trying to somehow make sure that you're all consistent with what you all think is a true theoretical value, right? So, somebody might get, if you're solving for I and that I in Ohm's law is supposed to be 5 amps, if somebody gets 4.9, there's a tendency to erase that 4.9 and write 5 in its place and then submit that lab report. Now, why is that relevant to us? It's relevant to us because that's, of course, on the one hand it's cheating because you're not reporting your actual observations. But second, you're not even acknowledging the fact that different people doing the same experiment can end up getting different results without necessarily contradicting the basic theory. In fact, that's far easier to see if you think of the coin toss. So, if I ask you to toss a coin and let's say that it's a fair coin, if I ask you to toss a fair coin 100 times, what do you expect to get? It's a fair coin, it's being tossed 100 times. You'll all answer that the answer for the number of heads, if that's the variable of interest, so x is the number of heads, what should be the value that x takes? You'll say 50. 100 tosses, fair coin, 50 heads. If you actually do the experiment, question is, will you see 50 heads? And if you take all the people in your auditorium and you get each of them to do this experiment, are we saying that each of them will see 50 heads out of 100 tosses each? And of course, the answer is no. It's highly unrealistic that all of you will see the same value. In fact, the probability that all of you will see 50 heads in 100 tosses, all of you, is practically zero. Even if I take one person to carry out this experiment per center and you toss this coin 100 times, the odds are that you will see a value 30, 31, 32, all the way up to 49, and then on the other side 51, 52, all the way up to 80, the odds are higher that you will see a value in that range compared to exactly getting 50, right? Yet the tendency is to report back and say that experiment was done tossing coins. The coin was tossed 100 times, The answer that we got was 50. So what's the point of this? The point is that we tend to bias ourselves in how we report our results. We do not acknowledge when we all report the answer back as 50, we do not acknowledge that we have seen different measurements, and fundamentally we are not acknowledging that the process underlying the coin toss experiment is a random experiment. Okay, so remember what the random experiment said. It said that you could expect a range of values. What values? You could get any number of heads when you tossed a coin 100 times between 0 and 100. That was possible. It also said that you don't know what you will get as the actual outcome of an experiment till you actually do the experiment. Right? So you can take a fair coin where one would expect to get 50 heads out of 100 tosses, but it is perfectly fine to see a variety of outcomes near 50. But then theoretically it's also possible to get 5 heads out of 100 tosses by sheer chance, okay, when you do this experiment. So if you have 168 centers in our workshop carrying out this experiment independently, at least one center may be expected to get a highly abnormal number of heads in 100 tosses, and that is nothing wrong with calling that an experiment with a fair coin. That's reasonable. So it is reasonable to once in a while see an extreme observation or a measurement. Okay, it is reasonable and consistent with the theory that you're proposing. So the question fundamentally then comes up, at what point, okay, is your measurement reasonable, and at what point is it unrealistic and you think you've got yourself a biased coin, okay, and therefore a biased experiment. So it's important to recognize that we are working with random variables and not with constants. So I don't want, for example, in a coin toss experiment to hear back that we're getting a value of 50 each, because that 50 implies that it's a constant value. It's not a constant value. It's a range of values that I expect to see as the experiments get done. Okay? And when undergraduates do experiments in labs, it's a range of values that I expect to see as different batches carry out the labs, and not the same value, because if it's the same value going on, something very suspicious is going on. So now in terms of random variables, if there's a range of values that I can expect to see for any measurement that I make in any experiment and not one fixed value, then that implies that I need to start talking the language of probability. Because I've got to start asking, what's the probability that I'll, for example, see 50 heads in 100 tosses? And what's the probability that I'll see 30 heads in 100 tosses? And at this point, both are perfectly reasonable outcomes when I toss a coin 100 times. Right? Of course, 50 heads out of 100 intuitively occurs more frequently and is more probable than 30 heads out of 100. So exactly how much more probable is something I need to work out, and that requires that I describe a probability distribution, which is basically a statement of, for each outcome that you expect, with what probability will that outcome happen. So what is probability itself then? So how do I define probability? So probability is the likelihood of something happening. That's one way to describe it. But if you're going to talk of it in terms of actual experimental procedure, it's about what is the frequency with which you see an outcome you like or expect relative to the number of trials that you've carried out. So if you think of the coin tosses, 100 coin tosses as the number of trials, with what frequency are you seeing heads given all the 100 tosses? So that's a probability. So the moment we talk about measurements not necessarily being constant and measurements varying on us, we need a probability distribution. And the moment we talk about probability distribution, we're then stuck with asking questions like, what is the average value on average? So 100 tosses, what's the value on average? We say 50. But how much variation can I expect to see around 50? So what's the variance? Okay. So the moment we realize that our experiments have random variables, we need three other things immediately. We need a probability distribution, we need a mean value, and we need to describe variation or variance. And I'll just quickly put up two probability distributions that are commonly used. Again, if you pick up a book on statistics, you'll be able to go through these in some detail. So the binomial distribution, for example, is what describes the likelihood of seeing k heads in n tosses. So when we are talking about 100 tosses, here's this function which will tell us this probability. A probability is a value between 0 and 1. So this small p on the right hand side here talks about the proportion of heads that one might expect to see, and since we are talking of a fair coin, this p on the right hand side is 0.5, because we expect to see heads with probability 0.5 on a single toss. And given the probability of heads as 0.5 on a single toss, what's being asked on the left hand side is, what's now the probability of getting k heads in n tosses? So that's the binomial distribution. And if you look at a sketch of this binomial distribution, it's a discrete distribution. It's discrete because k can take on only integer values. You can't have a fractional number of heads. So if you look at this distribution, if the proportion p of heads is 0.1, and I'm tossing this coin 10 times, so my n is 10 here. If I'm tossing this coin 10 times and I'm looking at the number of heads, then I should not expect to see a large number of heads, because this coin is biased towards giving me tails. That's what p equals 0.1 says, and that's what this shape of this distribution is telling you. It's not symmetric around 5, it's in fact leaning towards the left, leaning towards getting more tails than heads. And in fact, if I work with a fair coin, so p equals 0.5 instead, then you will realize that there's symmetry around the value 5. And if I go to the other extreme and go with a coin which is biased towards giving me heads, 90% of the time I get a head, then this now is a set of black dots on the plot, which tells you that you've got yourself a distribution skewed towards giving you more heads than tails. This is a binomial distribution. Okay, we use it quite often to describe processes where we have to work with integers. But really, the most important distribution for us in research is the Gaussian distribution, or as it's also known as the normal distribution. Okay, it defines or describes the variation of continuous measurements. This is a distribution which has two parameters in it. Okay, it has a parameter mu, which is the mean, and it has a parameter sigma square, which reflects the variance in the measurements. So what kinds of things would follow a Gaussian distribution? For example, the distribution of heights of people. So if you look around you, okay, in your room, if you look at the set of people in your room and you get their heights and you come up with a histogram of their heights and you ask what's the probability of seeing somebody of a certain height, that distribution will follow a kind of bell-shaped curve around the average height. So that's a Gaussian distribution. So the Gaussian is a symmetric distribution. The mean corresponds to, so if you take the red curve here, the mean corresponds to the center point of this distribution, and the variance sigma square basically tells you how fat each curve is. So the variance is small, like for example with the center curve here, the tall curve. If the variance is small, it's basically telling you that you've got very little variation in your data and you've got yourself a high probability of seeing the mean, which is the center point of that curve. So there is also something called the standard normal distribution, and this comes about in statistics as something important for us, because if I want to compare a distribution of the sets of heights of people with the sets of weights of people, then it turns out I'm going to look at different curves. So if I look at this particular distribution, you'll realize that I have an x-axis, and on the x-axis I'm plotting, for example, heights of people. So the heights of people may follow, let's say, the red curve. So what kinds of questions would you then ask of this distribution? You'd be asking, what's the proportion of people who are shorter than 3 feet? What fraction of people are shorter than 3 feet? So you'll have to say, here's the distribution of heights following the red curve. Here's the average height. For the sake of argument, let's say the average height of people is 3 feet. Then the proportion of people less than 3 feet is the area under the curve to the left of this particular location, and that's 0.5. Of 50% of the people. But then you could be asking questions like, now knowing the heights of people, but also having measured the weights of people, and that's the green curve, you'll start asking, what's the correlation or what's the connection between heights and weights? Are heights and weights of people related? And now you can start asking more advanced questions like, is that group of people with heights less than 3 feet related to a certain group of people with weights less than, let's say, 50 kilos? So how do I come up with such comparison? So essentially, I'm comparing an area under the red curve with an area under the green curve, and that gets a little awkward. Okay, comparing areas, first of all, between different curves, and of course, heights and weights have different units, remember. So plotting these on the same axis is itself problematic. So it turns out that one convenient way to deal with this is to standardize. And standardization involves taking a measurement and asking how much does an observation, in this case xi, to what extent does an observation xi deviate from its average value, the mean, relative to its standard deviation. So I realize I've not yet defined the standard deviation, but the standard deviation is a measurement of how much deviation you see on average from the mean. So the question fundamentally being asked now as you standardize the measurement is, relative to the average value and given the variation that you see in general with your data, how unusual is this one observation xi that you have. So it turns out that if I take any variable and you standardize it, it will consequently not have units. So if you look at the units of z, remember that xi, mu and sigma all have the same units. The net result is it's easier to work with transformed variables because they do not have units, and it allows for easy comparison of things like heights and weights. And given that in our model building, we are looking at a variety of variables which all have their own units, and because we want to make kind of sensible comments about all of these variables, we got to figure out how to quickly compute probabilities associated with the measurements of our variables, and these cannot be a function of the units. So why do we need these parameters in a distribution? So if I go back to the Gaussian distribution had two parameters, the mean mu and the variance sigma square. So what is the mean telling me? The mean is telling me where is the average measurement likely to happen, and what the sigma square is telling me is how much variation I can expect to see. So therefore, how much spread exists in my data set. And why is that useful? It's useful because when we do our research and we collect our measurements, you're going to end up with a huge matrix of data. And really, you don't want to be walking around with a large matrix of data. What you want to do is to figure out, is there some curve which explains the spread of data that you see? And it's far easier to walk around with a function describing this curve than to walk around with the entire matrix of data. So it boils down to asking, what shaped function describes the data that you've seen, and then how do I represent that function that I've just identified in terms of values of average or centrality? So the mean is a measure of average, and how do I also reflect the spread that I've seen in my data, and how do I do that given that I am now representing my data with an equation or a function. So at this point, we are working with random variables. We are working with these because we know that every single measurement we do has some uncertainty associated with it. The moment we have a random variable, we know that we've got to describe the variation we can expect to see with our measurements. That requires us to talk of probability distributions. The moment we talk about probability distributions, we need to be in a position to talk about what's an average measurement we can hope to see and how much spread might exist with our measurements. Okay. And this for each and every variable in your analysis. By the way, there are other ways to describe these shapes of curves. One can ask, is the curve leaning to the left? And we saw that with the binomial. Is the curve leaning to the right? We also saw that with the binomial. So that's skew. We can ask if a curve has been flattened. That's a higher order description of the shape of a curve. But basically, in one crude, simplified sense, what we are doing is when we collect our data, we are asking what kind of shape function describes the spread of data that we see. And knowing this function, where basically we're headed is asking, when we go about getting individual experiments done with individual measurements, is that individual measurement of a variable, is it normal or is it a very unusual event? So if I happen to know that the coin toss is following a binomial distribution using a fair coin, where I expect 50 heads out of 100 tosses, then I need to know that shape of that distribution. And given the shape of that distribution for each and every outcome of coin tosses, I need to then be prepared to ask the question, when I next do an experiment and I end up observing that I get 20 heads in 100 tosses, is that 20 a normal event or is it too unusual, particularly relative to this value of 50 that we have claimed is average. And effectively where this goes is, you start asking, if somebody is making a claim about some model parameter, if somebody is, for example, claiming that acceleration due to gravity is 9.8 meters per second square, and you start doing a set of experiments and you come up with your own measurements of G, and you set up a distribution for values of G, the question will get asked, when an individual later on goes and does his own experiment and sees a value of 9.5 instead of 9.8, how unusual is 9.5? Is 9.5 a reasonable enough estimate of 9.8 given all the measurement errors that you have, that actually, okay, what you are seeing is not contradictory to your original theory? Or, as it will turn out, the alternate conclusion you can arrive at is 9.5 is so extreme relative to 9.8 and relative to all the values that others have seen, that the claim that acceleration due to gravity is 9.8 is wrong. So it turns out that if you want to make any informed comment about any parameter in a model, given that you have some uncertainty with your measurements, you are going to have to come up with some estimate of whether the observations you are seeing are reasonable or not. Okay, and that sets us up with ultimately the hypothesis test. So we'll break for now.